and gentlemen, welcome to the second. Are you okay? You're fine. No, mini. Yeah. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the second session of the first Jagran Cinema Summit. The overall theme of summit, as you know already, is the future of film. But the fact is, there is no future of film because the film doesn't exist anymore.
Silence.
I think you're clapping for me, Yamadu. What the hell? Whether you watch a film, so to say, in a theater, on your mobile phone, on TV, on your laptop, it's all gone digital. In fact, the film star, as we call them, is the digital star now. Now, I'm here to introduce the panel. The most standard thing that most people who introduce panels do is to say that our panelists need no introduction. I mean, obviously they need introduction. In fact, they deserve an introduction for the simple reason that no people in any room have answered the question we're asking today as well as those guys who are sitting here. The question, of course, is, does size matter? Of the screen, of course. And with us, ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for Vivek Oberoi. He is the first Bollywood star to embrace a web series, Inside Edge, on Amazon Prime. Now that is as huge a call as something that Amitabh Bachchan took in 2000 when he moved from films to television for the first time. He was the first big star to do it. And the man who was responsible for it is sitting right here, Sameer Nair, ladies and gentlemen. Sameer has done television, has done film, and is now betting huge on digital. Another person who's bet hugely on digital is Ajay Chakko, ladies and gentlemen. Co-founder, Array, one of the finest web platforms we know, the most irreverent, the most fun at this point. And thank you for reminding me, Srishti. With us is Srishti Bell. Please give a big hand. Thank you for reminding me, Vice President of the Film and Television Producers Guild. Now, when it comes to the screen, what the screen really does is affect films and television. She's done both.
Good.
Anne is also now doing digital. Last but not the least, because I have to use some cliche, is, ladies and gentlemen, Madhu Mantena. Please give a big hand. Madhu was the founder of Phantom Films, which got the big bounty from Netflix to make the first original series in India, Sacred Games, starring Saif Ali Khan and Nawazuddin, which is currently being shot as we speak on the streets of Bombay. Now, whether that particular show goes global or not is what we'll also debate. But I can tell you one thing for a fact, this is going to be a world-class panel discussion led by our MC and a fantastic moderator, Miri Mathur, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Mayank. Right, so huge scope for this discussion. I think it's something that's just been waiting to happen. And like Mayank said, there is no panel other than the one sitting on this stage that can really take it head on. I mean, there are many, many aspects to this, but I think I'll throw the first question to Ajay. You know, Ajay, you seem to have invested out of the entire panel. You know, you're probably invested hugely into the digital platform. Do you believe that when you started it, did you believe that this was the sanest investment you could get into for the future? Or, I mean, do you think that it had reached the optimum point in which you wanted to jump in, or were you looking at it as something that would eventually happen in future when you started Array?
So interestingly, I've actually spent a lot of time in various parts of the media business, right? Like way back from the print era to about 10, 11 years in broadcast television and now in digital, right? So it's almost like, you know, starting afresh. But I think the big change that is happening and that relates to the question of screen size is the reason I'm here in this business is that I think the family as a content watching unit is under threat, right? So if you see eventually, you know, from people wanting to watch things together, whether it was in the theater or whether it was in the television screen, in India especially, because of the fact that there is access now, every household that has one television or every locality that probably has half a theater has actually 2.5 mobile phones, 3 mobile phones per household, right? So all of these guys are actually ending up watching something which is very different from what is available for communal watching on television or communal watching in theaters, right? One of the reasons also why these media are under threat from various fronts, not just from the fact of the economics of the business, but also the kind of storytelling that has been doing around, right? So we've got into the business primarily because we believe that there is enough room today, and we're still at ground floor on that one, for storytelling that is very, very individual-led, like in the sense that something that really relates to me and not necessarily my whole family or my community or whatever, right?
So in a sense, content has become personal instead of something that addresses
yeah, so
the entire family.
To use the word personal is a slight cliche, but I think it's become less aggregated from a watching experience point of view. And therefore, themes that actually resonate with individuals rather than communities actually have great potential. And therefore, I think the heart of this business, again, is coming back to storytelling, right? So therefore, the most, I mean, Sameer will also know,
exactly.
Others also know that the guy who's back in the heart of the business is the writer again,
yeah.
Right?
So we come back to the cutting edge content that Aray puts out a bit later. But Sameer, you've pretty much been on the cusp of all changes that the media has seen, starting with how you turn, you know, star into the lead in network by identifying and then going in for, you know, appealing to the middle class who was really left out, and then moving to film and then onto digital. So I need to know your entire quiver of arrows and why you took on that change firstly.
Okay. But the whole quiver of arrows?
No. We'll get to the. I'm saying one by one.
Okay.
I will analyze your quiver of arrows. But
I thought I could just start by, you know, on the topic of this,
sure,
what
sure.
we are talking of. You know, does the size of screen matter? And from where I've come, so the thing is that the size of screen, as we see today, how audiences are playing out, that it doesn't matter to a consumer. So you can watch a movie in the theater, you can watch it on TV, and you get a pirated thing. You can watch it on your mobile phone. You see live sport, you see it on TV, and if you have friends over, you make it, put it on a big screen. So you tend to consume content on any screen as a consumer. So to that extent, from a consumer's point of view, the size of screen doesn't matter. You know, as in, we see it in a flash multiplex, my driver sees it on the phone. But when you, so I mean, that's the way it sort of evolved. So we had TV, then we had film, now we've got digital, and essentially these are just new consumer-facing screens. The content is the same and people make their choices. So they see TV, they, you know, you have a more personal experience and you want a bigger screen experience. And in fact, a lot of us in homes have got much larger TVs now. You know, when everyone says it's all going small, it's actually going bigger. But this size of screen does make a big difference to any kind of economic model, right? So it's one thing to say that consumers will watch content anywhere. But finally, whenever content is being made, it's being made for some primary scheme. It's got to start from somewhere. And I think that often dictates how all these things happen. So an end usage is, of course, across everywhere. And so like even, I mean, in my experience, you know, when we first were doing TV, and then when we got a big star onto television, there were the economics of television that allowed us to do that, right? Later in the movie business, it's the economics of movies that allow you to do some things. The digital business is driven by its own economics. So I think that is going to be a very big deal in trying to figure out where this business goes, this whole content business from here.
But just as an add-in to what you said, do you think that the content of one format is going to eat into the other two, or is it going to just enlarge the pie?
But actually, you know what? It's not about eating so much into the other two as much as it's purely share of time. That's what we are fighting for now. We are not even fighting for share of wallet. Because the way this whole market has evolved is that a consumer is not going to watch crap for free. You know, they're not going to do it. So what we are really fighting for now is share of time. That's why some movies succeed and some don't. Some shows work, some don't. You know, anything works or doesn't work because the consumer is not willing to invest time in it. Money is the smaller matter. So it's what is happening now is that consumers are making choices. So you have X type of people who watch TV, others watch movies, they don't watch TV, they watch English, they don't watch English. It's those choices, the choices you make. So I think it all coexists, you know, up until the economics work.
Yeah, absolutely. So we discuss the economics of it. Madhu, Like Mayank told everyone, the first Netflix original series, after a series of you know, films that you've made, you're doing the first web series. What is the thought behind Phantom getting into web series?
It's very difficult to talk after Samir because there's nothing left to say.
we'll tap into it for the more serious matter.
So, for Phantom, which is a production company which is led by filmmakers that I work with, their basic life comes from exploring stories, right? So when you have a two-hour format, and as we can see, drama is moving from, or rom-coms are moving from the big screen into a series, because there's 8 hours to explore those characters and tell audiences stories and dimensions of characters that was not possible before to keep them engaged, right? Television no longer has monotone characters. They're complex characters that get audiences to be invested in what they're going to do over the whole series. Now, that's a great platform for filmmakers like Vikram and Anurag to explore. And so if they want to tell a real dramatic story which doesn't need a big screen experience, then why not work with the best actors and tell it for the small screen?
So are you saying that now the content will decide its medium? For example, why would you, if you have a compelling story, ideally, it would go on to any medium and still be a compelling story. So are we now dividing where content will be viewed?
Yeah, but I'm saying if you're telling a story like Sacred Games, you don't want to make it into a five-part feature film, which is releasing 1 year away. It doesn't lend to that. How do you tell Sacred Games unless you tell it as a as an eight-part series? How do you tell the complex stories, what they've been able to tell? But this Netflix series is being told at the same scale.
Yeah.
We are saying you don't need to pay $150 and come and see drama at home in the theater. It may not be, because screen is also about experience, right?
Yeah.
You want to see a Bahubali in a theater, and studios across the world have stopped making 22 films a year. They're making only 6 blockbusters.
Correct.
Because they're saying the big screen experience lends it to itself to another story, while the Netflix and the Amazon experiences lend themselves to other stories. And a 5-minute content will lend itself to another story. So I think all of these stories, both in terms of ambition and both in terms of how you want to tell them, from a creative point of view, I would never tell Sacred Games for the big screen.
Wow. So let's ask Vivek then. Vivek, you were the first guy to put your chips on the table, you know, walk where no man had walked before. What were you thinking? I mean, how do you now sort of be the voice of big screen actors who are willing to take the jump and, you know, actually put themselves out for a good 80 to 100 days to do a series? Are actors also looking at it as a sort of a reduction in stardom, or are they looking to reach out to a more global audience that maybe a film can't take you to?
So I think, Mini, that's a really interesting question. For me, the career choices I've made, whether it's debuting, even though I'm second generation, not getting my daddy to produce, you know, a launch pad movie for me. Dekho mera beta kitna acha dance karta hai, kitna acha romance karta hai, kitne acha designer kapde pehenta hai. I decided to jump into the fray with a film like Company and wanted to be taken seriously as an actor. So at that time also I was told the same thing. I was told that this is harakiri. You know, you're going to destroy the opportunity that you had. You should have done the Abbas Mustan film. You know, your father was producing. But it panned out okay. So when Inside Edge came to me, and I loved the idea, I loved the concept, I thought it was revolutionary, it was path-breaking. And a lot of advisors told me again, nahi yaar, mat karo, you know, you're making a big mistake, you know, reduction in stardom, and all those kind of fundas. But I took a calculated risk, Mini, because I calculated a simple thing. I said that even with all the multiplexes set up today, you have a statistic which tells all that 2 to 2.5 crore people across India actually go out to the theaters and watch movies. We're so below saturation in terms of the infrastructure to allow people to go out there and see a movie. So here you have a comparative when you say how many people are holding smartphones up right now in the audience there or checking as we speak. There are 40 crore people with smartphones in the country already and growing really rapidly. So I have now access to a distribution medium for my content that can penetrate 40 crores versus an infrastructure that can just give me 2.5 crores of access. Why wouldn't I choose that? Why wouldn't I want to leverage that? It liberates me from the whole, you know, pehlaj nihilani type of, you know, censorship issues. It liberates me from having to grovel in front of, you know, a multiplex chain saying, yaar, please, yaar, dopahar ka show mat do, subah ke show mein koi nahi aayega, yaar, shaam ka show de do. It liberates me from all of that. And now it's appointment viewing, right? So I've convinced you, inside edge, dekho. And then you decide, main raat ke 3 baje dekhunga. मैं बस में देखूंगा, मैं ट्रेन में देखूंगा, मैं गाड़ी में देखूंगा, मैं घर पे देखूंगा, मैं अकेले देखूंगा, दोस्तों के साथ देखूंगा. सो इट रीडिफाइंस एंड इट ब्रेक्स दिस होल स्ट्रक्चर व्हिच वी हैव बीन स्ट्रगलिंग टू यू नो कंफर्म विद यू नो स्ट्रक्चर वेयर एज अ फिल्म इंडस्ट्री पर्सन आई फील फ्रस्ट्रेटेड दैट यू नो व्हेन आई गो टू अ थिएटर गाय ही सेज कि ठीक है तुम्हारी पिक्चर में मैं इन्वेस्ट नहीं करूंगा, तुम्हारे लॉस में मेरा लॉस नहीं, लेकिन एवरी टिकट सोल्ड आई एम गोइंग टू टेक 50% ऑफ योर रेवेन्यू एंड आई वोंट शेयर कैंटीन रेवेन्यूज विद यू. The footfall that you bring True. When you do a Bajrangi Bhaijaan and you have, you know, so many people coming in and buying popcorn and samosas, I see no money out of that collection. So it kind of makes it very democratic. It levels the playing field and makes it fair. And I think that's the future of cinema.
It does, but just to extend that question, would you also look at a series that has been directed by somebody from the world of film, and even though now it has budgets that like big blockbuster films have, do you think you will still be showcased with the same quality? I'm talking, of course, India-specific here, not what Tom Hanks and Spielberg did for HBO.
It's a very valid question. So when I did Inside Edge, Karan Anshuman, who had already shot a film, came on board to shoot this. The budgets were bigger than most films that, you know, I've shot in a few years. And the publicity budgets were bigger than the biggest blockbuster films that we have today. And the highlight, I think the cherry on top of the cake was when Roy Price,
yeah.
who heads Amazon Prime globally, gave an interview in the Economic Times saying that Inside Edge is now, which is an Indian production, proudly so, is now the most binge-watched show in the world across their platform, across all languages. Even the English shows haven't done the numbers that we have, despite the budgets being 4 times or 5 times. So sure. To me, that was
amazing. And that means yeah. we've come of age, really. Just, you know, Madhu, I'd like your take on what Vivek just said, but thankfully, the digital medium now, at least the web series, you know, market doesn't really conform to the star system. You don't need a Bollywood big box office opening. You can just let it out there and let the content speak for itself. Why do you think then that a Vivek Oberoi would be critical to a project?
Well, he's also a terrific actor.
So I just wanted that said.
And you know, terrific actors end up becoming terrific stars.
Sure.
And I
Thank
think
you,
anybody who's working in the digital medium needs to be a terrific actor, because you have to hold audiences' interest for longer periods of time in a binge watching. Somebody watching
that would be
10
your criteria.
Hours of content constantly, and to hold somebody's attention, unless
sure.
it's being made by the best, how do you cater to that?
Sure. I'd like to bring in Srishti now, who's always, you know, told me that she's one, you know, she has no filters when she's on a panel. So I'm kind of counting on that. So Srishti, as you know, you've always been leading sort of cutting edge content, etc. Over the last few years, Amazon Prime, Netflix had come in. They're bringing in sackfuls of money, offering it to producers, doing what the studios did with films. Do you think that as TV producers, I mean, do you think this could also be viewed by the TV producer from that perspective as, oh, let's make a quick buck, let's make a good show while they're still offering it, and then, you know, sort of leave? Or are you looking at it as an opportunity that you were waiting for to be agnostic of the format and just tell your story for a good budget?
I don't think it's the TV producers who are trying to make a buck right now. It's currently the feature film producers who are making the quick buck.
my next question. How does it, I mean, they seem to be offering it to film producers where Madhu will attack you immediately, so.
I think there's more money in television than features and even Amazon.
I agree.
So HD is saying nonsense.
No, but I just want to get a
I've seen her house, I can attest to that.
Well, that's a discussion for the latter half. But Srishti, what do you, I mean, on a serious note, when you are getting that budget from bigger digital platforms to tell your stories the way you want to, what is the thing that you would like to sort of take forward? The fact that they're giving you enough money to make something you couldn't make on TV because of the censorship, because of the audience, what you're catering to, etc. Are you now feeling a little braver in, you know, your storytelling?
You know, it's a very exciting time for all content creators because we are getting access to different audiences. We're getting also specific audience access if we so choose to have. Like Array's got a whole bunch of people watching who are not necessarily watching Star Plus or Sony. But it's not just a budget call because honestly, I can't complain. My last show was episodically very close to his show in terms of cost. So it's not, it's about the reach, like he was saying. It's about the economics, about what works out. What is exciting is that we're getting to tell new stories in new formats. To take forward what Madhu was saying, there are certain stories that you can't tell in a two-hour format. They don't lend themselves to be franchise films either because they're not episodic in that sense. But at the same time, you don't want to be stuck every time on a TV serialized format where you got to end in 22 minutes. You know, you may have a story, or that episode may work to 30 minutes, another one might go to 40 minutes, and within a certain parameter, you work out, you tell the story for what it is. That's the beauty of digital. And to agree with Sameer, in fact, the size of the screen, if your story is engaging you beyond the point, unless you are talking about a Bahubali, it doesn't really matter.
But Sameer, you know, what I really want to know is that, do you think that since you have, you know, you were at a time with television when you know that the middle class was ready to be engaged and therefore you spoke to it. Do you think that the infrastructure that we have at the moment, whether it's broadband service or whatever, is ready to support this sudden propelling flush that we've got with the advent of digital? Is it happening too soon? Or are we ready for it?
No, I think we are totally ready for it. In fact, see what happened with TV, when TV grew in the 90s, when satellite TV first started, the way it grew was that the channels arrived, all the satellite channels, and then we grew the cable business alongside. So in reality, the content business and the distribution business grew together. So each time we launched a new channel, we were also hard at work in, you know, throwing wires from building to buildings, connecting up these homes and building the cable industry. So that's how satellite and the technology grew. Today, where we are is that in many ways, technology has gone ahead. There are 900 million mobile phones. They are threatening to have 500 million 4G connections, right? There are some 400 million smartphones. So in reality, this time around, the screens are already there. The technology is already there. And albeit, it doesn't work, and sure, calls drop, and it's buffering and all that, but it's all improving. In the meantime, what's happened for content is that, you know, in 2000, we did KBC, and then along with KBC, we did the famous K-soaps, you know, Kyonki, Kahani, Kasoti. So what happened was that those shows, of course, and that programming genre became outstandingly successful, almost like a killer app, you know. I mean, it was wildly successful. Everyone did it. All the channels followed suit. And now what we've had is a full generation of the daily soap. So in reality, television has not produced smart content in 20 years, right? Television has not. Now in the medium, Bollywood has. Every year, cinema makes mainstream and smart. Yes, you make a Dangal and you make a Pink. You do that. Yes. You know, you make Sultan, you make Urta Punjab. But television has been primarily daily soap across all languages. That's entertainment. That's the opportunity. See, the tech is already there. The screens are already there.
The primary reason for the shift to digital is actually TV not being able to cater to urban youth, right? That's really where it started.
Correct, but then that would make it... Sorry, Madhu, you were saying?
And it's no longer curated, right?
Yeah.
It's no longer curated.
Well, for now, but some say...
It's democratization of if you can find 100 people who want to see your content, you can make it.
You can, but then...
I'm just saying, you're not beaming it to anyone.
You're not.
So... You can make it, put it out there, people come and watch it at their convenience, so you can find large masses which you thought was niche.
Correct. So that is the next question about monetization.
Also in terms of the infrastructure. So for example, today with Inside Edge, There's a bunch of people from rural India who've loved it, who write to me or connect with me on social media, and they would have otherwise gone to see the same film if I'd made it on film, because they would have to drive maybe 2 hours to get to a decent theater to experience the film. They would have very simply gone down, downloaded it online, and you know, done a whole piracy scene.
Exactly.
And watch it. Because not because they didn't want to pay for it, but like Sameer said, the share of time. It's just too much of an effort. 2 ghanta kaun jayega, theater mein picture dekhega, it's a whole day gone. So this way, they can watch it at their convenience,
true,
at their location, and they don't
mind
paying
for
it.
That's good for them, but what about, I mean, what about now producers, now that film producers are also making, you know, web series, do you think that now the issue of piracy becomes a sort of all-encompassing issue for something like this, which relies on monetization for its niches?
See, if you look at it actually, for a film producer, piracy is a problem only when it's playing in a theater. Because in a theater, you're charging per individual. And you're afraid that if there's piracy,
yes,
then you know, your revenue goes down. But for a film producer, while piracy, I think technology is going to make piracy redundant.
Your films are premiering in six weeks on digital.
And it's now available on,
sure,
Hotstar. And like he said, it's not about the wallet. I think piracy is happening at a very, very lower income place, which there is, and it's fine, because all of these platforms are doing their economics in the legitimate business that they see. It's not affecting their bottom line. So I don't think piracy is such a big problem in the times of Netflix and Amazon. It was a bigger problem when there was no Netflix and Amazon.
Sure.
Today, that for people who can pay, we're charging them money. They're not trying to pirate it.
The other thing that I think I would like to touch upon, and I found out through my experience this being a very interesting differentiator, is that today when, say, you make a really cool film, a really smart film like a Pink or a Queen, the problem is that you make a film, say, for 15 crores, but to give it the kind of release across, say, 3,000 screens, 4,000 screens, so that the whole country sees it, because I believe in this film, will cost me more than I paid to produce the film.
Sure.
Cost me more than the content. So the distribution cost is prohibitive. Whereas, and I have to grovel to try and get those cinemas, to that degree of cinema, and theater owners just won't give it to me. But this becomes fair, because it's the same network. If you have, say, the Prime app downloaded across 5 crore phones, then you have access to all 5 crore phones. If they believe in your content, if they like your content, you could do the same business or the same viewership as a film that is, you know, 5 times as expensive.
No, absolutely. Brings me to Ajay. Yeah. Ajay, which...
This is a, sorry. So you.
No, I mean, please go ahead and say what you want to, but I'll just add my 2 bit. So you're actually putting content out there that is edgy, that's quirky, you're saying it like it is, you're not... pandering to any existing masses, you're creating your own path. How does monetization figure for you? I mean, are you still in search of the big pie that will come to you, and hence it will make it easier for you to say it like the way it is?
So one of the important points he touched upon was the fact that, you know, with every passing generation of change in media, right? In print, we used to spend 75 paisa out of a rupee in distribution, right? In television, it became close to 50 paisa. In digital, I can put 75 paisa out of 1 rupee in content. Right, so that's really one big difference that has happened. Yeah. Two, I could reach out to 150, 200 million people right now, which took us about 10 years in networking to kind of build that kind of reach, and probably 1,000 crores plus for, I mean, 1% or less than that money, right? So the whole distribution problem and the fact that, you know, you can put a lot of money in content as against on a lot of peripherals and bells and whistles changes the whole game. So when you say, you know, I'm actually catering to a niche, some of these niches could be like a show like Aisha, which was a sci-fi web series, which was about a sci-fi thriller, right? A strange sort of genre to start with. Reaches out to about 45, 50 million people without us having to do anything much, right?
That's amazing.
And the model is pretty much ad-funded in India to begin with, right? To begin with, it's ad-funded. It moves on gradually towards subscription. That's a move that took about 20 years for TV broadcast to, you know, kind of mature, right? I don't think that's going to happen in 2 years or 3 years, though Sameer and team have been very brave to go just subscription with Alt Balaji and all.
Yeah.
But it will evolve. Most of the models in India are pretty much ad-funded, and they will remain so for a long period of time, right? You will have one end where the Netflix subscription is there, which is about 100,000 people.
Yeah,
or
that's the
people.
Flushed with funds.
But 200 million people are on ad-funded, right? So how do you create great quality content in ad-funded environment is a good question to ask. And that's a full debate to be had, actually.
Yeah. Yes, Madhu?
Ad-funded also comes with restrictions, right? Ad-funded also comes with restrictions. In
absolutely.
Terms of the content that you're
no,
making.
No, absolutely.
It's not as democratic as what
I
you're doing on Alt or
I agree.
On
I agree.
Amazon.
I agree. It will come. It will
it
come.
It comes
yeah.
with restrictions.
Yeah, it comes with restrictions. How do you break that thing is a point of debate for another.
But I think there's growth, right? And the other thing with ad content is today, for example, I mean, not to bash anything, but BARC ratings or TAM ratings before that. When I actually wanted to know about it, when I first did a television show, a reality show on television, I said, what are these ratings all about? And I found out that pure Hindustan mein
2800 boxes and
you know, 12,000 or 15,000 homes. How can you create an effective sample from that? But digital is changing that because now real time, I have data of who geospecifically in what part of the country is spending at what time, what are their viewing patterns. And then if you know that the same person is buying stuff on e-commerce, you know their taste.
You know that it's leading.
It's big data, you can digest that big data, you can analyze it, and then you can convert that into further sales. So I think that it's not going to be primarily either ad-driven or primarily only subscription model driven. I think there's going to be a lot more, you know, a lot more layers that will emanate as this grows. I think we'll see a lot more disruption in the next 2 or 3 years.
Sameer, this is a question I really need to ask of you. Like, we had TAM ratings, we had data to sort of substantiate the kind of content that TV was putting out some time back. Do we have enough data on who's watching what, where, and how, on what size of the screen? Do we have enough data companies which are analyzing this for marketers to say, you know, put in more money?
On digital?
Yes.
On digital, the platforms actually are essentially big data companies. That's what they do fundamentally. Mm-hmm. That's their game. So, I mean, what Vivek just said, that now on digital, you know exactly who's watching. Down to the individual.
No, I meant to correlate to people who actually, big corporates that are spending to aid storytelling.
So what's happening now is that, like, for example, and just on this ad model, since you brought it up, I'm not such a big fan, is that, see, finally, advertising requires eyeballs, right? That's what advertisers go after. They need a whole bunch of eyeballs. And so any model that is dependent on advertising needs to deliver that number of eyeballs, right? And experience. And so that's the challenge of that. The subscription model, on the other hand, requires, it's really, rather than calling it subscription, I like to call it crowdfunding. You know, it's like how movies operate. When you release a movie in a theater, a whole bunch of people buy tickets and go and see the movie. They're all contributing towards that grand experience, right? So in many ways, subscription models work in that manner, and they're not dependent on advertising. But either way, whether you want to know, you know, whether you want marketing or advertising or subscription, there is a lot of data that comes through this. Like, I mean, YouTube offers a lot of data. All the platforms have data, and everybody has a pretty good idea of who's watching, what they're watching, how much they watch, and all of that is
so in a sense, a lot more transparency.
And it's
more
available. I mean, you get to know everything because
there's only one
that.
One aspect of data which is missing, which will also get plugged very soon, which is across platforms. If there is like a unit of content that is available across like 10 platforms or 8 platforms,
which is being accessed.
So how is that being captured? I think there is some move towards capturing that also. BARC is working with Ecom and Nielsen, etc., to get that in. Hopefully, it's not a sample-based survey. It's actually
that would be pretty.
You know, there's another thing that I want to say. I mean, you just mentioned in terms of transparency. I think more than transparency, it's about efficiency. When a corporate wants to advertise, the first thing they do as an exercise between their marketing and their agencies is identify their TG, that this is our target group. Now, suppose I'm somebody who's just doing a project in Gujarat, and I want to only sell to people in Gujarat. Now, I have geo-specific data that if I choose this particular show on Array or that particular show on Amazon Prime, this is the viewership in Gujarat, and this is the TG of that viewership, whether it's youth-based, whether it's slightly older, and I can actually target that specifically and pay only for Gujarat. I don't have a hammer across India to try and get my customer in Gujarat. So it kind of is a big disruption in the advertising space.
Can we have some
space.
Silence at the back, please? Thank you. Sorry.
It's a big disruption in the advertising space, and I think it's more bang for buck. It's more directly correlated to what my target audience is and how I want to reach them and the quickest, shortest, cheapest way to reach them.
Sure. Just one thing on that, on this whole advertising thing, is that, the most click button on the internet is the skip ad button, So we all know that, right?
I love it.
So the move is towards getting rid of advertising, getting rid of that interruptive thing, right? Ideally, what you'd like to see is a movie without breaks. I watched Dangal on Zee. It took 4.5 hours
Absolutely.
To watch it.
Absolutely.
But I braved through it because I wanted to see it. But I'd like to get it over in the 2.5 hours that it was supposed to be. So this advertising is something that, you know, advertisers are also groping with this new world. Because now like an Amazon and a Netflix put out Inside Edge, all 10 episodes, available tonight with no breaks. Right? You can actually give
binge watch.
eight hours of your life.
Binge watching.
There is a lot of evolution in that also, Sameer, now. You know that, right? So it's like, one is obviously India has one of the highest rates of ad blockers and skipping and all of that, right? But there is enough now, if you look at the number of people who've actually built businesses around brand integrated content.
But I think these are two separate things. These are two separate
permanent roommates. I was just going to say that.
Exactly.
I don't take away from advertising at all. Listen, all of TV works on that, right? Advertising going nowhere. They are the biggest paymasters for everything, man. We need them.
I
think monetization will have a lot more things. Say, for example, what I see as the future is tomorrow I'm doing a show and maybe it's in a fashionable world and I tie up with a fashion house and maybe I don't have them advertise in it, but then I do enough feature around it saying that, okay, the artists wearing these clothes are directly available on this website. And I give you that information. So I think there's a lot of ways that they're going to come up with in terms of being able to monetize.
There is actual integration from left to right.
Absolutely.
You know, Srishti, there are, for a lot, I mean, I know a lot of people who grade content on, you know, ye hum cinema pe dekhenge, ye to hum DVD pe dekh lenge. Ya fir now it's like, you know, we're going to watch this when it comes on TV, like Sameer watched Dangal. No excuses for that. You saw it in the theater as well. Okay. So do you think we are now actually creating, we're looking at storytelling in a different way. Okay, like you said, you know, there's some stories that cannot be told into us. So are you now creating content which is not just agnostic of what you're doing, but you're actually creating content which only addresses, you know, the size of the screen? So for example, you're creating stuff which will be told in 10 parts. That is it a story idea that just gets to you?
See, I think that is that's the most exciting thing for a content creator, is the ability to tell the story to the person you want to tell it to. What happens is that when you talk about mainstream blockbusters, because the costing is so prohibitive, and all these distribution hassles and putting it out there, and we have all those kind of things. So when you overcome that, it has to be an event movie for you to travel 2 hours to go and watch something, because it's not going to be justified to you on your telephone. On your phone screen, right? So similarly, when you're talking to me, digital, I know, I mean, of course, one has a widescreen, big TV and all, but for me, I'm still watching my digital content on my laptop in bed and binging all night, right? So the story is more intimate, according to me, and it's more in-depth when we are trying to say something. I want to see all the layering that happens in that.
Yeah.
And when I'm watching something on television, not, but
so my question was that, is your storytelling going to be now more intimate, more one-on-one, because clearly you can't put up a huge backdrop or have scale when somebody is eventually going to watch it on your smartphones?
No, so to
that extent, will your storytelling change? Sorry,
Game of Thrones
on a smartphone?
How many people are watching it on a smartphone? How many people have put their,
talking about India.
My wife is watching something else, I see it on the smartphone.
No, but you know, the thing is, it's very presumptuous of us to assume that in a country like India, everybody has access to flat screen large TVs.
Yes.
Most people are still in the 2G world, not even 3G. I mean, with Jio, everything is going to change. So they are looking at that kind of thing, and they are not watching Game of Thrones.
Just one thing. I mean, this thing about it's a small screen and how can you watch it on that, is that for a larger audience, see, you know, in the US, when the iPad first came, the iPad was the exact same size of the in-flight screen, right? Because you are already conditioned to watch, you watched all the movies on flights on that screen. So it's not, the size of the screen is not the point. See, there's a primary screen which made Game of Thrones in a primary revenue model. After that, you dub Game of Thrones into Telugu, and then everybody and the uncle are watching it on small phones. It's you can see it. It's not about that should you watch it or not. Obviously, you should see it on a bigger screen. But you can see it. That's not the size of the screen is not the point.
Also, there's a lot of technology disruption happening. Like, I'm invested in a technology company right now. We're creating a small box. And that box, you put it up in rural India. You put it up any corner of the country. And what it allows you is to convert an old, you know, black and white TV into a smart TV, where you can actually watch digitally streamed content from your internet service provider onto an old dabba TV. You don't need to have a new smart TV. You don't have to change your you know, investment infrastructure there. So there's so many people working on so many exciting things like this. And this box, like for example, when I was doing a little bit of research, I found out that ek ghar mein do TV bhi hain, lekin ek cable connection hai. So there's issues like that.
Yeah.
And whereas something like this, the idea of this box would be to put it up in one house, and instead of taking three cable connections in a house,
you can just
you're watching it through one, and it's streaming across the whole house. And you can watch different content on different outlets. So you could be watching a Saas Bahu serial, and somebody else could be watching Game of Thrones in the same house from the
story,
same single
ghar
box.
Ki kahani, like I would say. Madhu, is this making multiplex, you know, the multiplex is a little insecure. I mean, we just, you know, read about, you know, a struggle between distributors saying that, oh no, you can't put it on digital as soon as 6 weeks. And does it change the way, you know, the multiplex owners are looking?
Windowing has been always governed by groups of either by the governments or by associations across the world, right? Because you're trying to make sure that all the screens survive. Just because new screens and new sizes of screens get added, that's not the death of. I mean, we'll always like to watch movies as a community, right? I mean, it goes back to the whole fact of going sitting around a fire and listening to a story. A community watching of a film is a very different experience from a individual watching the same content on his phone. So each screen provides something else, right? It either provides scale, it provides community watching, it provides family watching, comedies. Why do comedies have laugh tracks, right? Because we're used to watching those in community watching, and that's how. So nobody's threatening anyone, but they'll all coexist.
It's a big threat, yeah.
It is. I mean,
look at the listed companies. Look at the.
One second. My thing is.
Somebody separate the two of them.
So the problem is we haven't changed our content.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
So because we are 5-6 years behind in development, this process has happened. This is coming together, but Avengers is going to get made. Bahubali is going to make 1,000 crores. Because our development cycle is behind by 4-5 years, we are facing the threat today. We are going to adapt. We are going to make Avengers.
That brings
we
are
going to make you come to the theater to see that movie.
Madhu, I think what Ajay is trying to get at is that we'll eventually have to create different content for different mediums, isn't it? Because,
no,
because
but the
otherwise
larger
you're just
the content,
creating...
See, the film content can get repurposed. My song that I will make in a film, 250 million people will see it. The film may not work, but that's repurposed content. So just because I'm re-editing that content and I'm doing more numbers doesn't make that
so
content any
less. So you're saying it
less.
Makes no difference to, you know, anyone...
If we don't adapt, Hollywood is going to take over. That's our
yeah,
threat.
I think that's the key question is there enough contextual current storytelling to attract people to theaters in a sustainable sort of way over the last 4-5 years? At least from a listed company perspective, the multiplex business is seeing a sharp drop, right?
Yes.
I mean, it's actually, we used to actually own a multiplex chain in Network 18, right? Stargaze and all. So it got like Carnival bought it and all of that happened, right? So we realized that early in the day that it is not a business, though people were saying things are moving from single screen to multiple screens, it is a business that is seeing tough times. And the reason why it's seeing tough times is
because
of the
software. They're multiple, yeah.
The software,
yeah, yeah.
Right?
And now that the software is not doing well, people will adapt. So it's an arc,
yeah,
right? It's a learning arc, and content will change. The infrastructure of the theaters is not going anywhere. How you feel about going to a theater is not going anywhere.
Sameer, do you in the future see, apart from the fact that you make a piece of content and it travels through film and then it eventually goes, you know, airs on TV and finds its way into digital, do you see different kinds of storytellers customizing different kinds of content for different size of the screens, or do you think it's all going to be one big hot mess eventually finding its
way? No, not a hot mess. It's already different. So in the sense, let's see, when you make a movie, all movies by their very nature are 2.5 hours or 2 hours of a start, middle and end. So that's that format. Television currently, which has a daily soap on it, is driven by the daily soap telling, which goes on for 250 episodes and then into...
But it is also being consumed on digital, so you have to...
No, when a movie is consumed on digital, you know you're consuming a movie.
Yes.
When you're consuming daily soap television, you know you're consuming daily soap television. And now when you consume smarter series, you're consuming a different type of storytelling. So obviously, what Array does is produce a whole range of different kind of content. Right? Array is not making a movie or saying that watch my Aisha in a theater, because it doesn't work that way. So actually, this is a golden age for content now. See, what we got stuck is that you either make a movie or you make a TV show. Right? There was no third option. So you either wait in queue to get a slot from a channel and you get it and good luck, and or you make a movie, so you get a star and you get, that whole, it's difficult to do these things. Now the whole digital world allows you to create a lot more, whether it's short form, whether it's long form, whether it's series, all of that, you can do it now. And it's pretty democratic, it's out there, you're able to do it, you can get ad supported, you can get subscription, there are different ways to skin this cat, and it's a good time, because, and the advantage is, technology is ahead of us this time. Right? They are way ahead of us. These guys have gone and connected 900 million people.
Yeah.
You know, and we have no new stories to tell. Oh, well, we are not yet started telling them.
So many, to take from what Samir just said, see, and you've been kind of hitting on the thought that is content different for different screens?
Correct.
Now, I have a little bit of a differentiator there. Now, cricket matches, one of the most watched events in this country. They were originally designed for you to sit in a huge stadium with massive infrastructure, 100,000 people together screaming, shouting, and enjoying it. That shifted to television. Now suddenly people are sitting in a TV, in front of a TV with 20 people around and screaming, shouting, and enjoying it in somebody's house. They're all watching, you know, a match, whether it's a big screen TV in an urban setup or in a gaon ka setup where it's the house that has the TV. Then it moves on further today to Hotstar, where it's being beamed live as you watch it and you're enjoying it, and the experience, sharing experience there is a little different. Now what happens is you're parallelly on an app like a WhatsApp or a ShareChat or an XYZ with your friends, and you're saying, oh my God, can you believe it? This happened. Oh, Virat hit a six. And then you're sharing that. So the experience is now changing. It's not that you drive to my house, all of us will sit together, you know, I'll order pizza and we'll all watch the match today.
That's the end of
so
that.
So the experience is changing.
Hmm.
And I'd like to say, I know Madhu kind of feels very strongly in one way, in terms of infrastructure, but I think the infrastructure is going to become a dinosaur if they don't adapt.
And I think that feeling is already prevailing.
Yeah.
Right?
Madhu. There's another animal that is also, you know, in a tough spot, which we again were associated with. It's the cable and the DTH business, right? So just the thing that he's pointing out, right? Hotstar is streaming IPL matches. Tata Sky has paid X amount of hundreds of crores to Star, saying, okay, give me rights for the match and what have you, and I'll set up it. And this is available pretty much like almost free. The economics is still being sorted out, but there's a huge challenge right now, right? You pay 625 rupees a month or 500 rupees a month for the sports pack, et cetera, or you pay 119 rupees or even like free, right? Hotstar is right now free.
Sure.
So, and watch the IPL as well, right? So the whole infrastructure model will also be partly a victim to all of this as well. I mean, the software will have to kind of adapt, but it's also a victim. It's not like as if things are going to be the same always, right?
And you can
you can't
and you can cast from Hotstar onto TV.
No, absolutely.
That experience of sports is completely
I don't think
different.
It will anybody's point.
Madhu, you're shouting. Okay. We'll give him one sentence to make his point. You have to make your point. He doesn't own stake in a multiplex yet. Not that way, you know.
All of them are good friends.
Honestly, Shifty, you wanted to say something pertaining to that? Otherwise,
I agree
have
with
something
to see, the thing is that it's not actually, I think the question of the screen size is not the relevant question. It's the way of consumption that is the question. It's on demand digitally. On television, it's appointment viewing where people are still watching together. And a film is an event. Okay, so there's three different forms of consumption.
Completely.
We are the enemies of our own selves. We are the Yeah, we are. Because if we put out poor content, that is going to damage us way more than what any other medium is going to damage us. The minute you put something out that is worthy, people come out and watch. Right?
Yeah. See, sports moved into TV, I have to say this, because we shot it better. And we gave you beers at home. So it's not...
Sports is not like yeah, it's not that. But honestly, I'll throw this question open to Vivek before I throw this forum open to questions. How long before we make a truly world-class, our own Narcos, our own Game of Thrones that goes out there and captures everyone's imaginations?
It's been done. It's called Inside Edge. You should check it out.
Nice plug. Nice plug. On that note, anyone who wants to ask our esteemed volatile participants' questions. No filters.
It took someone as wonderful as you to keep it together. Thank you.
I'm just balancing it. There's a lady here. Yes, ask your question. Can we have a mic to her, please? Are you going to ask a question or can we take one from the front first?
Can I go ahead? Or?
Yeah, just ladies first. हाय विवेक, मेरा क्वेश्चन ये है कि क्या कंटेंट को लेके सेंसरशिप की बात होती है कि इंटरनेट पे सेंसरशिप नहीं है इस वजह से कुछ भी दिखा लो, तो क्या कंटेंट टीवी में ऐसा नहीं हो सकता कि ऐसा कंटेंट बनाया जाए जिसको सारी ऑडियंस देखे और सेग्रीगेशन आपने किया है, लाइक मोबाइल में यूथ देखेगा, टीवी हाउस होल्ड देखेगा, तो ये सेग्रीगेशन भी आप ही लोग बढ़ा रहे हो?
सबसे पहले मैं कहूंगा थैंक गॉड की सेंसरशिप नहीं है. Censorship is an outdated concept. Censorship, in its true sense, if you read the act, is supposed to be a guideline. It's supposed to tell you, yeh content adult viewing ke liye hai. Agar aap dekhna chahte hain, toh aap dekh sakte hain. What pricks me the most is that 18-year-olds who can vote and decide who's going to run the future of this country can't pick what they want to watch in a film. Whether Bond's kiss is 7 seconds too long or, you know, 14 seconds too short. I mean, it's ridiculous, the degree of censorship in the country. So I think jahan par digital ka sawal aata hai, there are a lot of things, like I have young kids. They may use the same devices that I do, but I don't want them to see the shows that I watch, right? They may have adult content, they may have violence, and I don't want them to watch that. So there are a lot of locks that are available, parental locks that are available on every device now. So you can easily control that.
Sure. Sir, your question here?
Yeah.
आप कुछ पूछना चाह रहे थे?
एक सवाल मेरी तरफ.
Yeah, hi.
A couple more questions, then we'll take a break.
Ganesh here. I am from Bombay, and I have my own language institute. We are teaching, training actors and actresses various languages.
So your question
and
is?
And coming to the question, the content we were talking about over here, many a times it's been seen that the content in the beginning appears to be very interesting. But later on, the interest dies down. And naturally, in fact, you know, the interest, once it dies down, the goodwill also, you know, reduces. So my point is, like, you know, there are two aspects to it. One, if you are a very strong, you know, diehard writer, content writer, sometimes it does affect the content writer or the cinema on the whole, because there are a lot of people going against, the content or the content what is being advertised.
That's the longest and most complex question I've ever
heard.
You have
come to the question, sir.
Yeah.
Just waiting for the question.
My point is, can't we have some content which will keep the mass attracted like the earlier days? You know, that's what is my, I hope you have understood, or if not.
Well, I haven't, I think I should give you this chair.
Okay.
No, may I answer
the,
that?
The,
yeah, may I answer that?
The content
if
is...
If you're done with the question, may I answer that?
Please go ahead.
The thing is that, you must understand that the glory days are always days in the past. We are right now also creating some very interesting content. Yes, there is a problem on television because of the relentlessness to expect people to keep, writers to keep writing at that level. There is some great writing happening on films right now. And because of the breaks that you get in seasonal formats that you do on digital, there's some great content happening there as well. When you're talking about the past great days, there were very few access points. Right now, there are various access points. And what is relevant to one is not necessarily relevant to everybody anymore.
Right. There's a gentleman there, right in the back. That's our last question. Okay. We'll take your question. It's a question, right?
Samir sir, आपसे एक सवाल था कि जो target audience हैं, इनके लिए जो फिल्में या television shows smartphone पे देखते हैं, तो सबसे ज़्यादा potential जो उनकी purchasing capacity है, वो किन के पास है? Smartphone मतलब किस मतलब tier one सिटीज वालों में या मतलब रूरल वालों में या मतलब किन में?
अभी क्या है कि देर आर अभी काफ़ी बड़ी परचेसिंग कैपेसिटी है बिकॉज केबल सैटेलाइट होम्स कुछ 165 मिलियन हैं, उसमें से 70 मिलियन डीटीएच होम्स हैं, 2 मिलियन उसमें से कलर्स इन्फिनिटी और स्टार वर्ल्ड और नेटफ्लिक्स देखते हैं. तो ये जो बीच का जो ऑडियंस है गोइंग ऑल द वे अप टू द डीटीएच होम्स, इन लोग काफ़ी पैसा खर्च रहे हैं. उनके पास डीटीएच कनेक्शन है, उनके पास 4-5 फोन घर में हैं, वो 2-3 पिक्चर महीने में देखते हैं, वो तो एनीवे पैसे खर्चते हैं. तो इट्स अ वेरी बिग ऑडियंस. यू नो ये ऑडियंस को मैं बुलाता हूँ द ऑडियंस बिटवीन नागिन एंड नार्कोस, वो बहुत बड़ा है और उनको ये स्मार्ट कंटेंट देखना है. तो बहुत बड़ा है ऑडियंस, इतना छोटा नहीं है. टीयर टू टीयर थ्री नहीं, आई मीन इट्स अ बिग अर्बन ऑडियंस.
लेकिन उनकी एंटरटेनमेंट एपेटाइट किस तरह की ज्यादा है?
सी एंटरटेनमेंट एपेटाइट है कि अ लॉट ऑफ दीज ऑडियंसेस हैव लैप्स्ड फ्रॉम टीवी, दैट इज दे आर नॉट वॉचिंग टीवी एज मच. पिक्चर तो देखते ही हैं, दे वॉच ऑल द स्पोर्ट एंड ऑल ऑफ दैट स्टफ. तो अगर ये होल सीरीज बिजनेस और स्मार्ट ये जो नया आ रहा है, अगर वो और आए तो वो कंज्यूम करेंगे. आई मीन आई थिंक द एपेटाइट इज ह्यूज बिकॉज ऐसा कुछ हुआ ही नहीं है इंडिया में.
और
इस पर स्टोरी, देयर इज अ लेडी राइट हियर इन फ्रंट, आई थिंक
एक सवाल बस था कि इस पर कितनी स्टोरी मतलब वन टू वन होती है, कि मतलब हम लोग सिर्फ वन टू वन इशूज को हैंडल करते हैं या फिर फैमिली सेंट्रिक, मतलब पूरी फैमिली देख सके वैसा मतलब कंटेंट ज्यादा
देखने के लिए? तो पूरी फैमिली देखो, इंडिविजुअल देखो, वो तो अभी देयर बी हंड्रेड्स एंड मिलियंस ऑफ स्टोरीज टू टेल. तो अभी तो शुरू कर रहे हैं स्टोरीज बोलने, तो अभी करते जाएंगे धीरे धीरे.
ओके, थैंक यू सो मच. वी विल एंड हियर एंड थैंक यू सो मच फॉर अटेंडिंग. समीर, सृष्टि, विवेक, अजय, मधु,
दिस
इज क्लियरली अ वेरी एक्साइटिंग टाइम for storytelling and for the size
thank
of this meeting. Thank you so much for being here. Can we have a huge round of applause? And that is the noisiest press I've ever seen from the back. Thank you so much. Right, we're going to take a short tea break and we'll be back with our second panel discussion. So please be back in 10 minutes.